It is now my pleasure to introduce our first keynote, Associate Professor Natasha Myers from the Department of Anthropology at York University, Toronto. In her ethnographic research, Myers examines forms of life in an interdisciplinary investigation of the contemporary arts and sciences. Her book, Rendering Life Molecular, Models, Modelers, and Excitable Matter, published with Duke University Press in 2015, is an ethnography of an interdisciplinary group of scientists who make living substance come to the fore at the molecular scale. It won the 2016 Robert K. Merton Prize from the American Sociological Association's Science, Knowledge, and Technology section. Myers' current projects span investigations of plant-people entanglements in a range of contexts, including the arts and sciences of vegetal sensing and the politics and aesthetics of garden enclosures in a time of climate change. Most recently, she has launched a long-term ethnography on restoration ecology and enduring colonial violence in Toronto's High Park oak savannahs. Moreover, Myers is experimenting with the art of ecological attention through a combined research and creation project, Becoming Sensor, together with award-winning filmmaker and dancer Ayelen Liberona. This project, Becoming Sensor, engages art and anthropology to design protocols for an ungrid-able ecology grounded in decolonial feminist practice. Among her many other engagements, I could mention that Myers is the convener of the Politics of Evidence Working Group, director of the Plant Studies Collaboratory, co-organizer of Toronto's Technoscience Salon, co-founder of the Write2Know Project, and she's also on the editorial board on the journal Catalyst, Feminism Theory, Technoscience. And today, Natasha Myers is going to talk on the subject Seeding Plant People Conspiracies to Root into the Planthroposcene, 10 Not So Easy Steps for Growing Livable Worlds. Please.
It's so wonderful to be here, and I wanted to thank you for your generous introduction, and also to Jens Hauser for this wonderful invitation, and to be here among you for such an astounding series of events that will unfold this week. It is such a pleasure and honor to be among so many brilliant plant thinkers, so many brilliant thinkers of unthinking and transforming how we think of green. So what I want to share with you today weaves together a series of concepts and practices that have been shaping my thinking for decades. 20 years ago, I was abducted by the plants and pulled into their spiraling whorls. At the time, I was a dancer and a plant scientist. More recently, I've become a dancing anthropologist of art, science, and ecology, moving with and being moved by the plants and following them where they will take me. So just to prepare you for what will follow, I should warn you that this is less a research talk than an incantation, a hypnagogic experiment in speculative fabulation. My intervention today makes the impossible an utterly comedic form of a step-by-step guide for getting us out of the Anthropocene. Consider this as an invitation to experiment with ways of dreaming differently. We have come to remember that we are currently living under a spell, and this spell is making our worlds unlivable. It's time to cast another spell, to call other worlds into being, to conjure other worlds in this world. This incantation channels both my rage about our current predicament and my playful and loving, but also serious aspirations for dreaming worlds otherwise. It is clear that we are reaching the limits of language and logic, and that we are at the edges of our imagination. We need art, experiment, and radical disruption to learn other ways to see, feel, say, and know. So let's begin. Step one. Never forget this. We are not one. Say it again and again. We cannot forget to keep asking precisely who is hailed by this anthropos, that figure positioned at the helm of the Anthropocene. Anthropocenic rhetoric calls out man as the agent of his own demise, and also simultaneously vaults him into position as the only viable savior of the planet. Even as Anthropocene thinking aims to call our attention to and finally hold us responsible for the egregious effects of our actions, it still centers humans as a singular figure, transcendent over and separate from some Edenic nature in peril. These narratives recenter rather than decenter man as the agent with natural dominion over this planet's future. Do not get distracted by the misplaced concreteness of scientific efforts to articulate the physical markers and temporal boundaries of a geological era made by humans. What we are witnessing is the apotheosis of 500 years of colonial violence, extractive capitalism, white supremacy, and the hubris of human exceptionalism. The capitalocene and the plantationocene, Donna Haraway and Anna Singh's concepts, are apt monikers to identify the forces that have long been active at work terraforming this planet. These destructive forces are propelled not by all people, but by those particularly egregious ways of doing life modeled on self-aggrandizing man. Remember this, not all are hailed by this figure or form of life. Capitalism and colonialism are not to be mistaken as the natural or innate forms of human existence. They are not inevitable consequences of some human evolution or the forms of our civilization, but they are the condition of our current predicament. Anthropocene worlds are built on slavery and dispossession. Anthropologist Marisol de Cadena calls our attention to those anthropos not seen, those whose lives and lands continue to be spent in the accumulation of wealth by colonial and neo-colonial powers. These are the people who remain targets of dispossession and attempted annihilation today, even and especially as capitalism gets into high gear in its efforts to go green and save the world. Don't believe the hype of sustainability rhetoric. The worlds built by colonialism and capitalism are unlivable for us all. This would be one example. Step two, break this world to make other worlds possible. There is no way to mitigate anthropocenic violence using anthropocene logics. Refuse calls to design for the Anthropocene. Such designs are precisely the technological fixes that will keep us locked into the same rhythms of extraction and dispossession. Refuse to be lured into those climate change edutainment complexes, those gleaming glass, metal, and concrete infrastructures whose capital and labor-intensive designs exquisitely expose the roots of sustainability as an aesthetic maneuver grounded in Edenic visions of nature. This is not the kind of green that will save us. Yes, there are apocalypses already ongoing around us. The decimation of the boreal forest to extract bitumen on stolen native land in Canada is one such apocalypse. But giving into apocalyptic thinking is itself a kind of exit strategy, an easy out. Ruin porn, including those all too compelling images of plants rupturing through abandoned buildings in Detroit and Chernobyl, thrive on this narrative of a world without us. We are told over and over again the world will be better without people, without us. We are told that we should live in a world without us. Beware of such apocalyptic thinking. Anthropocenic thought catches us all up in the thrall of apocalypse and sets up to work furtively dreaming the end of times. We must refuse what Donna Harry calls the tragic detumescence of a narrative arc that is bent on pulling the entire planet towards unstoppable catastrophe. Do not be swayed to thinking that this is how it has to go down, as if apocalypse is precisely what will have been. Elizabeth Pavanelli is right to warn us about the perils of the future anterior. What futures are we setting in motion with our apocalyptic rhetoric? Resist the lure of apocalypse like your life depends on it. Yes, it's easier to dream the end of the world than the end of capitalism, but the only way to thwart the momentum of the Anthropocene is to break the spell of capitalism and activate processes of decolonization. And while it is clearly time to dismantle Anthropocene thinking, there is no need to wait until the end of this world to begin to conjure livable worlds. There are as yet other worlds within this world, and there are as yet worlds to come. But which worlds will be livable, and what makes a livable world? Step 3, repeat this mantra. We are not alone. We are not alone. We are not alone. Looking back over the past 500 years of efforts to assert Western man's independence from and power over nature, it is clear that we should never be trusted to act alone. Anthropocene thinking is so obsessed with man's independence, with unilateral action and autonomy, that it forgets that there are other forces and powers among us, including those with significantly better skills in the realm of world-making and planetary-scale change. In some cases, these beings have billions of years more experience than us in terraforming livable worlds. Step 4. Name our most powerful ally. Who made this planet livable and breathable for animals like us? Say it out loud, the photosynthetic ones. Photosynthetic organisms form a biogeochemical force of a magnitude we have not yet properly grasped. Over 2 billion years ago, photosynthetic microbes spurred the event known today as the oxygen catastrophe, or the Great Oxidation. These creatures dramatically altered the composition of the atmosphere, choking out the ancient anaerobic ones with poisonous oxygen vapors. If we were to continue to fall into the trap of naming linear time-bound eras after singular event agents, we might be rattled to think that we are living in the wake of what should have been called the Phytocene. Photosynthesizers like cyanobacteria, algae, terrestrial plants, and trees are the planet's most powerful agents of elemental rearrangement. An anthropologist of algae, Doygu Kazdagan, shows us that the science of photosynthesis, with its calculative metrics bent on extracting value from green beings, is too mired in the logic of naturalized capital. These green beings must be understood otherwise. That is, as practitioners of a kind of alchemical, cosmic mattering. We think plants can't move, but they reach out across the cosmos, drawing the energy of the sun into their tissues so that they can work their terrestrial magic. Pulling matter out of thin air, plants must be understood as world-making conjurers. Their elemental rearrangements teach us the most nuanced lessons about matter and mattering. More powerful than any industrial plant, communities of photosynthetic creatures rearrange the elements on a planetary scale. They know how to compose livable, breathable, and nourishing worlds. As they exhale, they compose the atmosphere. As they decompose, they matter the compost and feed the soil. Holding the earth down and the sky up, they sing in nearly audible ultrasonic frequencies as they transpire, moving massive volumes of water from the depths of the earth to the highest clouds. And for those still caught up in the thrall of an economy that fetishizes carbon, perhaps the most important art these creatures practice is sucking up with gusto the gaseous carbon emissions that we humans generate so abundantly. To say that forests and marine microbes form the lungs of the earth is an understatement. They literally breathe us into being. All cultures turn around plants' metabolic rhythms. Plants are the substance, substrate, scaffolding, symbol, sign, and sustenance of political economies the world over. We must learn how to work with and for plants so that we can be nourished and clothed and sheltered and pleasured and healed without destroying the earth. These plants are the world makers we need if we need to heed if we hope to grow livable worlds, and our worlds will only be livable worlds when people learn how to conspire with the plants. Step five, foment plant people conspiracies to root into the Planthroposcene. Repeat this again and again. We are of the plants. Now, if this is true, then the figure that should ground our actions is not the self-aggrandizing anthropos, so much as a strangely hybrid figure we could call the planthropos. And now try wrapping your mouth around this word until it rolls off your tongue with ease. Planthroposcene. The Planthroposcene names an aspirational episteme, not a time-bound era, one that invites us to stage new scenes and new ways to see and seed relations with plants in the here and now, not some distant future. And it is grounded in the wisdom of the ancient and ongoing radical solidarity projects that plants have already cultivated with their many people. So rather than circumscribing the terrors we face now, the Planthroposcene is an invitation to root ourselves into a way of doing life that would break the frame of Anthropocene logics. The Planthroposcene acknowledges the joint and uncertain futures of plants and peoples and demands we change the terms of encounter so that we can become co-conspirators to these green beings. Tim Choi makes a powerful call for us to think the concept of conspiracy otherwise. Rather than a sinister association, it forms for him the grounds for an aspirational politics, one grounded, one in which people learn how to conspire, that is, breathe with, breathe together in order to fight against atmospheric toxicities of industrial exuberance. But it's time now to extend his call of uniting people in a conspiracy of breathers. It's time to include the plants. That is, we need to learn not just how to collaborate, but also how to conspire with them, to breathe with them. For they breathe us into being. Remember this, what's good for the plants is good for everybody else. Centering the plants is not a move to displace other beings. Plants, rhizomatic forms, entangle them with all other creatures, including the animals, insects, fungi, and people. Get on side with plants. Consider yourself at their service. Get to know plants intimately and on their terms. And be sure to tap into their desires for forms of life that are not for us. Support their efforts to keep the earth cool and the waters cleansed. As Maria Puch de la Barajasa teaches us, give plants and their soils the space and time to flourish outside the rhythms of capitalist extraction and the chemical violence of industrial agriculture. Don't forget, plants need their pollinators. They need their fungal relations. They need their animal allies. Above all, plants need us to radically reconfigure how we stage our relations with them. Indeed, if plants are sun worshippers, perhaps we ought to be plant worshippers. A little reverence for the plants could go a long way. Invent rituals to honor plants that sustain you. Practice permaculture with the witches. Start a local church for plant worship. Don't worry, reverence for the plants doesn't mean you can't eat them, but it does mean it would be polite to thank them for their generosity. And just think, if we had to consult the plants, to ask permission to use them, industrial agriculture, strip mining, clear cutting, and expanding concrete, other than sprawl, would be inconceivable. Just ask, they will tell you. Step six, decolonize your common sense. decolonization means giving stolen lands back to indigenous peoples. And decolonization demands we reckon with and dismantle the overt and covert ways that settler states are structured on white supremacy, slavery, and the erasures of existing land-body relations through fantasies of terra nullius. Perhaps the first step towards decolonization would require that we detune our all too colonial imaginations. To do this, we would need to upend everything we believed was common sense. Does talking to plants sound crazy to you? Consider this. For millennia and still to this day, people all over the world cultivate deep and intimate relations with plants. Many have come to know plants' powers and predilections, especially those whose lives and livelihoods get them tangled up with the plants and caught in their spiraling whorls. There are gardeners, farmers, hunters, healers, herbalists, cooks, artists, naturalists, foresters, scientists, and shamans all over the world who consider plants as sentient beings worthy of address. Lots of people hear plants sing, though not necessarily in the audible registers you might anticipate. And at the same time, many people, perhaps even you, would think this is absurd. Sure, you read that story about plants in your Facebook feed. Science has confirmed that plant roots have a kind of swarm intelligence, unquote. But we don't need the disenchanting sciences of plant sensing to tell us what people who love plants have long known. What we do need is to make strange the disenchantment and skepticism we have inherited from those whose power was secured in part through sciences designed to invalidate all other ways of knowing the world. It was the colonizers, of course, who refused to believe local and indigenous people's claims that plants could sing. It's time to forget everything you thought you knew about the living world, especially what you believe is perceptible, imaginable, reasonable, legible, and meaningful. While you're doing that important work, don't forget that human exceptionalism is another colonial formation, one that violently evacuates the liveliness and sentience that would render more than human worlds in the form of all around us. Refuse the disenchantments of a mechanistic science that would render more than human worlds in the form of alienable bits of life and death, ready to be portioned off as property, resource, or commodity. Sideline colonial and capitalist moral economies that dictate what is good, valuable, and true, especially those that naturalize economic growth and extraction as the world, as the work that is proper to man. Refuse to discipline or deride local and indigenous cosmologies. Push back on every proportion or erasure or reduction that seeks to make such knowledge legible or commensable or rational to science. Do the work to make yourself receptive and responsive so that you can take these knowledges seriously. Make space for ways of knowing and storying the living world otherwise. And remember, there are people all over the world who have protocols, the know-how, and the responsibility to consult the plants. Livable worlds will need the people who know how to talk to the plants. So once you've set in motion efforts to decolonize your common sense, it's time to vegetalize your sensorium so that you too can learn with and alongside the plants. As a co-conspirator supporting their world-making project, you will need to apprentice with them. What do plants want? What do plants know? What can a plant do? We do not yet know. But you could reach toward them with the openness of not knowing and forgetting what you thought counts as knowledge. Consider this. Your sensorium, especially your senses of color, texture, taste, touch, smell, and more are already articulated by plant life. Their forms inspire your aesthetics and train your habitus and excite your imagination. From this perspective, is it clear that your senses are already vegetalized, and yet there is still much work to do to learn how to extend your synesthetic sensorium to meet their lively worlds. In order to waken the latent plant in you, you will need to get interested in the things that plants care about. Make space for plants to take root and take the time to watch them grow. Linger among them and let their sentiences and sensibilities alter your perceptions, how you think and how and what you know. Though plants don't have eyes, ears, noses, or mouths, don't be fooled. They can see, hear, smell, taste, and feel. Let their plenty sensitivities inflect your own. Tune in to the different ways they do time. Learn to follow their tempos and rhythms. Pay attention to the ways that they defy all too human notions of individuality, bodily integrity, subjectivity, and agency. Let the plants redefine what you mean by the terms sensing, sensitivity, and sentience. Let yourself be lured by their trochic terms, and you will soon acquire freshly vegetalized sensory dexterities. You can activate the latent plant in you through incantations, hypnosis, meditation, or yoga. You can try this by cultivating your inner plant through a kriya, where you can meditate on activating and deepen yourselves and photosynthesizing. Once you've decolonized your imagination and vegetalized your sensorium, the world will look and feel a whole lot different. You may begin to sense things you have never perceived before. You may get the feeling that you are being watched everywhere you go. Indeed, the plants and trees are not indifferent to you. They are paying very close attention to all the beings that ingather around them. They know how to lure you and their co-conspirators with force. Start with the plants and follow their inquisitive growth, their running roots and their rhizomes, the widespread movements of their pollens and seeds, and an entire ecology of beings and comings undone will soon become perceptible. Get caught up in the involutionary momentum that propels these beings to get entangled in one another's lives, and you will soon start to perceive affected ecologies taking shape in the thicket of relations all around you. Cultivate modes of attention that can pay attention to what matters to the plants and their co-conspirators. Becoming sensor, tune into this ecology of practices and practitioners. Follow the push and pull, the attractions and repulsions, the happenings taking shape in and around the plants. Get a feel for the ways that plants practice their arts at the cusp of life and death. With time, you will begin to detune your colonial ecological sensorium, and new worlds will open up into view. Develop protocols for an ungrid-able ecology, a mode of inquiry that refuses the colonialism, militarism, heteronormativity, and economizations of life that ground conventional ecology. Resist desires for legibility and statistical generalizability. Refuse attempts to calculate an ecology's energetic efficiencies or apply cost-benefit analyses. Invalidate metrics that would parse ecological relations into mechanical parts. Break all automatic, prefabricated sensors. Over time, you will begin to forget what you used to think nature was. You will forget, too, how you used to think life worked. And eventually, you will forget, too, the naturalizing tropes that made you believe that living beings work like machines, or that forests perform ecosystem services, or that reproduction and fitness were the only valuable and recordable measures of a life. Confront the colonial and capitalist desires of the ecological sciences. Say no to conventional ecologies extracting metrics that justify an extracted economy. Say no to, and beware of Anthropocene ecologies that reduce land care practices to resource management. Do ecology otherwise. Step 9, garden against Eden. Forget everything you thought a garden was and everything you thought a gardener was supposed to do. Your job in the Planthroposcene is to stage plant people conspiracies to keep this planet livable and breathable. Your primary commitment will be to support plant growth everywhere. Start by letting the plants grow where they want to. Let them break through the concrete, root into every fissure and surface. Grow through the holes of every fence. Don't be afraid of those plants you've been taught are out of place. Remember, those plants that we vilify as invasive species are markers of the ravages of colonialism. The plants themselves are not evil. They grow in what Anna Singh calls the ruins of capitalism. They grow on sites of dispossession. They grow where lands and bodies are out of relation. Before we poison the earth with glyphosate to attempt to erase the violence of colonialism and eradicate these plant invaders, we need to ask ourselves what the plants are doing here. What new relations have they set in motion? What are they up to? What does the land want? What does the land need? And how can we refigure plant-people relations to do less harm? The Planthroposcene uproots the infrastructures of those anthroposcenic cities that are founded on Edenic desires of a nature tamed and contained by man. Give the old order infrastructures back to the plants and the fungi. Let them decompose. Wild urban plant growth certainly does portend the decline of empire, but the Planthroposcene wild growth will not be read as a sign of ruin. Planthroposcenic cities will be designed to support plant life everywhere. Each surface will offer an affordance, a place for plants to root and grow and decompose. Perhaps someday you will conspire with the plants to grow your own home. Perhaps cities will grow themselves into cooling forests, brimming with nourishment. In the Planthroposcene, radical farmers like those at the Land Institute in Kansas will have succeeded in dismantling industrial agriculture by conspiring with the plants to bring back the plains, growing perennial grains in the form of regenerating grasslands. These perennial, nourishing grasslands will demand the return of the buffalo. They will resist erosion, retain water, and activate soil microbes. There will be no need for heavy machinery and chemical fertilizers. In the Planthroposcene, the capitalist imperative to grow economies will be subverted and supplanted by the imperative to grow livable worlds, to give plants time and space they need, to freely articulate relations with their allies, and to express their fullest desires. Humans will have to cede their biopolitical powers over lands and bodies. We will no longer be in control. Step 10, make art for the Planthroposcene. Refuse the aesthetics of ruin porn. Be assured that plant powers must not be constrained to sites of cultural decay and times of human extinction. Cultivate instead a taste for Planthroposcene porn. Art that keeps people in the game by staging intimate relations among plants and people. Follow Annie Sprinkle and Beth Stevens to make art that figures nature as lover, not mother. Art that lures us into the realm of more than human pleasures. Get down and dirty with Pony Express and learn to curate your own eco-sexual bathhouse. Even Darwin knew that plants could feel the buzz and hum of insect wings and the pleasures of touch. Join Stella Petrick and the Plant Sex Consultancy to design vibrators for lonely plants and flowers that have lost their pollinators. Activate your own capacity for cosmic mattering by learning Chimera Rosa's protocols for tattooing your skin with chlorophyll. You too can learn how to photosynthesize. Join artists from Dance Your Plants to create performances for the potted plants that are slow dancing on the window ledges of your apartment. Apprentice with Mexican artist Gilberto Esparza to design lively nomadic plant companions. Build the bodies of your plant machines from electronic waste harvested from capitalist ruins. Engineer those companions to draw energy from bacterial life so that when they suck up raw sewage downstream from toxic industrial flows, they can transform it into water that supports the plants and their allies. But whatever you do, make art like your life depends on disrupting with dissensus the colonial common sense that would leave us all to die in the Anthropocene.
Thank you very much to Natasha Myers for this infective incantation for the necessity of conspiring with the plants. Now there's room for asking questions or giving comments. So please. Yes.
Thank you very much for this great talk. you brought up a new term with the Planthroposcene, and I really like this idea. Nevertheless, I'm interested in how you relate to the green topic. And yes, what do you think about this term, and if you think it is still usable, or if it needs to be, yes, substituted by your term?
So green, green ought to be inspired, like our concept of green ought to be inspired by these vegetal beings, these photosynthetic ones, these algae, these terrestrial plants, these mosses, all of these green beings. And yet so many of our concepts of green have been tied to deeply economic concepts of life. So much of the science of photosynthesis has hinged especially on the question of how can plants be made fuel for us? How can we extract more from the sunlight, advancing the practices of photosynthesis in a leaf? So brilliant work is being done by Jojo Castigan, who is here, to think the history of, say, something like photosynthesis that gives us our ideas about the generativity and productivity of green, but those sciences themselves are so bound up in an economizing logic of extraction. And so my effort here, by reintroducing plants to us, these green beings to us in a new way, is to say, how could that transform our concept of green? So the green as a sustainability aesthetic that grounds so much of the architectural creations that we see today, these sustainability forms that that when you look at them quite closely, actually use much more resources, extract from our resources. They are labor intensive, they're capital intensive. And so the question is, can we redefine both the plants and our relation to them so that when we breathe in with them, the color green resonates in a totally new aura, a new kind of sensibility. So there's a redefinition of green here. Perhaps green will save us, okay? But it's not the kind of green that precisely what Jens Hauser presented to us, this remarkable set of extractive logics that attempt to aestheticize nature in some Edenic form. And so precisely the Planthroposcene is that opportunity to reimagine our relations with plants and redefine what we mean by green. Thank you.
Okay, thank you for a very inspiring talk. I'm in the back here. I was wondering, so besides working in academia, I also work for a consultancy that works a lot with the people who work with smart grid and smart cities and all these ecotopian ideas. So I didn't see, I saw all the architecture and all the ways of developing the world that we shouldn't do. And I'm always trying to figure out how to bring these figures into this world. So can you help me translating some of these thoughts?
So I think a lot with the artist Lois Weinberger, whose work you can see here. And also thinking about, how do we rethink the nature of a vertical garden? So this is what I would call a garden on the streets of Sydney, which itself was directly across a square from a massive edifice where workers were clambering up and down the scales of a large condo complex as they were planting a vertical garden, a garden that would have to be watered, that would have to be weeded and tended. And so this idea of potentially imagining what a garden could be, how a garden could be otherwise, I'll just bring you to another one of his beautiful images. This is Hans, this is also Lois Weinberger, right? What kinds of enclosures are we building for both the plants, okay, but also what kind of infrastructures are we building for this idea of a kind of an Edenic future of a green economy. And the question is, disrupting that imaginary takes so much work because the Edenic imaginary is so strong. And what we have to remember that Eden holds in it the fantasies of apocalypse. And my question to artists and designers, and this question that I think we have to keep in mind, is how do we transform our designs not to lock us into the future apocalypse, not to lock us into further extraction and further dispossession, but how can we design to generate and foment new kinds of relations? So would that mean creating buildings whose surfaces were affordances, porous and available to any plant that decided to come and take root? And so that in this sense, we also need infrastructures that are built for decomposition and decay, because we cannot keep moving towards a future with what Donna Haraway calls forced life, right? The gardens in Singapore are sites of forced life, where only plants that are in full bloom are left, and anything decaying or decomposing is ripped out of view. And so here, the question of designing for a different kind of future means disrupting an aesthetic form. So here, Lois Weinberger is watering weeds. What would it mean to sort of make ourselves allies to those weedy invasives, those subversive plants that rupture through the concrete, that don't grow where they're supposed to? Here we would have to actually disrupt our aesthetic form. So how would we do that work? Part of that work is involved in detuning. There's a lot of detuning and unlearning and forgetting that we need in order to move forward, is my sense.
Yes. We have a question of you.
There's already one.
Okay.
Hello, and thank you for an inspirational, visionary, and ambitious. Actually, I see it as poetry, if I may say that. The 10 steps, not so easy as you name it, seem to me as a redoing, and as you also say, a detuning of everything that we have thought was green and green and greenness. Mm-hmm. So, apart from the content in it, which is a lot, I also see it as a proposal for a plantopian then society world. So this is a new utopia, the planting, the doing, the 10 steps. But my question goes whether you would actually have some experience right now as to how to become this priest or priestess of these plant churches. Do you have some experiences in that?
Oh, wonderful question, yeah. And I would hesitate to call this a kind of utopia, and I would hesitate a little bit to name singularly just the plants. And what I want to hold together is that relation. What would it be like to hold, to never think that we have to remove people from the equation? So what kind of practices can keep us in the game, keep us participating, keep us alive and breathing with them? So the Planthropos is that hybrid figure. And utopias have this terrible this terrible reality of always coming undone. And so here, the 10-step program is a joke. I mean, in a really important sense. It's we are at the edges of our imagination, and we need to dream otherwise. We need to activate our imaginations in this form of speculative fabulation. But this is just one attempt in that direction. But if there's an opportunity for sort of activating another kind of thought, and I think that possibility of, say, beginning with cultivating your inner plants, and you can find the meditation online and practice it yourself. And quite quickly, when people have done this meditation all over the world at this point, including on Vandana Shiva's farm, off the coast of Norway in a tiny little island, truly people experience for the first time the possibility that they might also have roots. that they might also be able to photosynthesize. And so part of the work here is about disrupting this imaginary we have that plants are this radically altered form of being, and that anthropomorphism is the only way that we come to know them. So the invitation here is to make ourselves porous and be changed by plants. And so the idea of the Planthroposcene is that we would all become gardeners, that we would all be so busy tending our gardens and thinking and working alongside of the plants that the growing economy that we're supposed to be otherwise managing would be shifted, but we would all have a lot of food. so these are dreams of possibility, but one thing that I do as an anthropologist is I'm on the lookout for plant people conspiracies everywhere. And so right now I work in an ancient oak savanna in Hyde Park. This is ancient land that has grown up on the sandy dunes of an ancient lake bed. These beautiful composition of oak trees and tall prairie grasses and wildflowers cannot subsist entirely on their own. Turns out they need people, and they need people with the knowledge to use fire to keep the grasslands open, to keep the oak savanna lands thriving. And so we can look at a plant people conspiracy millennia in the making and ask ourselves, how do we keep these relations alive? It turns out that those fires are not just forms of combustion. Those are fires set in ceremony. Those are fires set on land that calls for it, land that demands it be burned. And so currently, when I look at the forms that people take in the restoration work on this land, you see they're using glyphosate to remove the invasive species. And so this is not the kind of conspiracy that will save us. And so part of it is to take a look at the amazing relations that are already alive all around us, the gardeners, the farmers, the herbalists, the healers, all of these people who have already been cultivating those relations. We can look to them as models, as powerful agents for bringing on the Planthroposcene.
Thank you very much for an absolutely fascinating talk. And actually my question will somehow ponder on what you have just said, because my question is in a way practice-based.
Okay.
my question will be quite simple, actually. There is a practice which somehow is in line with what you said today. I mean permaculture. Mm-hmm. So you consider that? I mean, apart from being academic and a researcher, I hesitate to say the owner because that's not the word, but I deal with the piece of land, mm-hmm. and I have permaculture garden, very mm-hmm. small patch of land in the mountain, and to me this is exactly an incarnation of what you said. So that's
absolutely.
My question.
Absolutely. So permaculture, even some forms of biodynamic agriculture that actually practice ritual for the earth, where there's a call and response, a relation set up, one of reverence, and a kind of deep inquiry into the beings and doings of plants and what it is that they want. So the remarkable practices of gardeners who've learned how to work athwart industrial forms, to work against chemical agriculture. And these forms of plant knowing, the possibility of beginning to expand and to share them are absolutely in line with this idea of the Planthroposcene. And yet, I want to do my permaculture training with Starhawk. Right. What would it mean to do the permaculture training through an altered practice calls on the witches, So and here this is where this question of reverence, right? So if they are sun worshippers, perhaps we ought to be plant worshippers.
I think this is a question.
Yeah, thank you for a really beautiful poetic, I think is a nice word for the talk, but I want to sort of push on the poetry of it a little bit, because one of the things that I think really sort of draws my attention in your words is that you're not speaking poetically, you're not speaking metaphorically. In fact, the more literally we take your suggestions, the more we attune to the political and ecological imagination that you're trying trying to offer to us, if I'm understanding correctly. Mm-hmm. And that seems incredibly important to me. This is not the first time that someone has suggested to ask for plants, right? Mm-hmm. I'm thinking of the sort of robust entheogenic drug cultures of the 60s and onwards, right? But really asking the plants being motivated by a very human desire for self-transcendence at that moment in time, when it was a very different suggestion being made, wasn't the end of the world. And so I'm wondering a little bit maybe if you could speak to not the poetics of your suggestions, but to the literalness of it, and to the ways in which the sort of the science of your background, and not just the poetry of your dance, matters to this project.
Absolutely. Yeah, in the past, people who've heard my work, I think, oh, it's just poetry. And I was like, each word is has an entire research program behind it. And the efforts here are to find ways of using language also, right? So the words do matter. I think a lot with Donna Haraway's concept of material semiosis, that words conjure new worlds, and that we can activate new thoughts by playing with the words, by playing with them. But underneath it, I would hesitate to call my work science at this point, though I have extensive training in molecular biology and developmental biology. And yet, I think we need to unthink some of those terms precisely by pulling ourselves into other sensibilities. I think what is at the core here is the altering of our sensorium, and the recognition that both what we can see and what we can perceive is conditioned by all of that which we are not allowed to perceive, what we are forced not to perceive. And so activating practices, and so I'm conducting research in gardens, and I'm conducting research in ecology, and I'm conducting research among scientists working on plant sensing and sentience, and I'm working among artists who are activating new imaginaries to push past the limitations of scientific stories. And so, as an ethnographer, each of these sites that I'm sharing with you I'm on the lookout for practitioners who are up to stuff, who are activating these processes in the world in real ways. And so there's an invitation to each of us, right? Because we encounter plants in all kinds of new ways. How do we begin that encounter? Just by walking out of the building. Maybe there are also plants in and among us. I was recently in the basement of doing a radio interview, and the host apologized that there were no plants around, and I was like, there are plants, plant roots surrounding us, burrowing into and around us. And so part of it is that activating our imagination, beginning to think of plants as creative beings, right? Not as sessile outgrowths, who are evolutionarily limited, but actually as creative beings conducting inquiry into the world, experimenting with light, gravity, and vibration in an ongoing way. And as soon as we start to decenter ourselves as the only kind of creative beings, we actually can begin to open up. And there are practices that people are doing that make all of this possible. You can come with me on a walk with my collaborator Ayelen in our land that we're working in Toronto, where we're trying to detune the sensorium with people who are lured to this site and want to find ways to connect in new ways. And they leave that space transformed, right? So there is in the space of an afternoon, the world will appear to you differently. And so these are the kinds of things that we can do in very mundane ways and ongoing practices in our daily life.
Actually, may I pose a question too?
Sure.
Okay. I'm really sympathetic to your idea of seeing the plants as kind of fellow beings, and your idea that we should conspire with them, mm-hmm. and maybe even go into sexual relations with them. Nevertheless, I would like to ask you about the ethical implications of really going deep into this, seeing the plants as fellow beings, because many vegetarians and vegans will abstain from eating animals because exactly
they have seen the animals as fellow beings. Mm-hmm. Nevertheless, we have to live from something. Yeah. So how can we defend eating the plants if we really see them as creative, sentient beings? Are we going there that we kind of, okay, we accept we kill them, but we appreciate them nevertheless, and there's a kind of necessity of killing and appreciation, maybe in the same way as Paleolithic hunters killed the animals, but nevertheless it seems appreciated them as really fellow beings. So my to put it very far out, if we go into this and we have to eat the plants but we appreciate them, would that then mean that we also have to say, okay, now it's okay again to eat animals because we appreciate them in the same way as we kill them?
So relation is something we have to think about, and we have to think about ethics relationally. And one of the things that the awakening to plant sentience should teach us is that all eating is a form of killing. Like, all eating has always been a form of killing. We've just been more concerned about beings that look more like us, right? And so when we begin to recognize that plants have been incredibly generous with us, right? They drop fruit for us. They lure us into caring for them and tending for them, and this incredible generosity they have. The fact that they don't have eyes or the norms of a nervous system that we would recognize to look back at them, this is a sign of the impoverishment of our ethical practice. And so, as a former vegetarian, I now eat meat. No, just kidding. Because I recognize that all eating, is a form of becoming with another. And if we had more reverence around food, right, we would thank everything all the time. Right? If we were gardeners participating with the plants and keeping them alive, we wouldn't be ripping them out with fervor. We would be asking which one was ready to give itself over to us and how we could tend it more in the future. So it's about setting up a totally different kind of ethical practice. And I found arguments around not eating animals and plants around the question of sentience to be incredibly impoverished, in part because our model of sentience hinges on scientific and philosophical arguments about those beings who can feel pain. Sentience has never been measured around those bodies that can experience pleasure, right? And so we've ended up with very skewed ideas about what consciousness is and what sentience can be. The scientists that I worked with for many years in molecular biology thought that the material world, the molecular world, was alive and meaningful and sentient. So all of these practices where people create intimate relations with things, they learn firsthand that the world is alive, it's lively, it's sentient, and waiting for us to respond to it in kind.
Thank you. I think we have a last question up there.
Right. Yeah. So we've ended up with very skewed ideas about what consciousness is and what sentience can be. The scientists that I worked with for many years in molecular biology thought that the material world, the molecular world, was alive and meaningful and sentient. So all of these practices where people create intimate relations with things, they learn firsthand that the world is alive, it's lively, it's sentient, and waiting for us to respond to it in kind.
I think we have a last question over there.
Yes. Hi, thank you. Wow, preaching to the choir, yeah. I'm concerned about communicating such ideas as an artist myself about what you just were discussing in your presentation, or beyond this world, beyond the choir. Because that's really what, because I think we're failing miserably to communicate this, you know. So, I'm wondering, just simply.
Absolutely. It would be a lot of work to transform my language and make myself heard in different media. So part of the work I do working as an artist with Ayelen Liberona is also not to work necessarily in text, right? To not necessarily work in the form of a language that might be alienated to people. So creating installations that alter our sensorium, installations that pull people in and invite them to experience phenomena in new ways, leading them on walks, guide, you know, this is slow work, right? We've all come to this space because we care in some ways about some of the questions that are animating this conference. And so we've had long histories that have brought us here, but there's a lot of care and a lot of labor that goes into expanding the publics that we have. My aspiration, I think that art can do this. I think that art can do it much better than, say, anthropologists, you know, standing there and giving us straight up lectures. I think that artworks and new forms of storytelling are precisely what we need. So in a sense, my excitement to be here among so many artists and so many practitioners who are doing that work is precisely both to give us a sense of we're not alone here, right? So we have a community that's doing this kind of work and propagating through the world these kinds of practices. None of this is readily scalable. And I think this is an important lesson. All of this has to be done in very local, individual, practical, daily, and mundane ways. And so this scaling up to large-scale political formations, I can't say that we're ready to do that work yet. But the slow work of expanding publics becomes really important. I think of the Becoming Censor work that I'm doing as a 100-year-long project, precisely because of the impossibility and the challenge of transformation that lies ahead of us. Thank you for your question.
Okay, we will take one more question over here.
Okay.
So this scaling up to large-scale political formations, I can't say that we're ready to do that work yet, but the slow work of expanding publics becomes really important. I think of the Becoming Censor work that I'm doing as a 100-year-long project, precisely because of the impossibility and the challenge of transformation that lies ahead of us. Thank you for your question.
Can you take one more question over here?
No? Okay, the final question for me. Thank you for this fascinating talk. My question is as simple as that. You're clearly calling for overcoming the human language for plants, greenness, greening, etc. Do you think it's actually possible to do it, to overcome our speciesness, so to speak, in the way we articulate, perceive, name, tag, planting, greening, etc., etc.? Because, you know, for me, it would mean giving up humanness, yes? And the language we have, and this is what we have.
So we've never been human. And so this anxiety and this loss of our humanness, I think, is what's at stake here. We have to get over that. We have to unlearn this idea that we were separate ever to begin with. And so if we do look around us, there are all already these people who are doing that work, right? There are already those people who embody the Planthropos, who have been whispered, you know, at by the plants, who whisper to the plants. There are those people, and so plants have pulled on us. They were here long before us. They pulled us into our cultural practices. They pulled us into bringing them into and expanding their domains, to expanding where they grow and live. We've already responded to them. And part of this is to say, can we do better with the ways that we have become entangled in plant lives and worlds? Can we build those relations more powerfully, more in ways that do less harm on the planet? So I think part of it is getting over very Western conceptions, and this is where an anti-colonial or decolonial thought is the foundation for decentering Western imaginaries of man, Western imaginaries of some Edenic nature in peril, separate from us. And so that's at the core of this reimagining. Thank you very much.
Okay, I hear there is some food which is a bit in delay, so actually we have room for one or two questions more. So if someone is burning.
Are we hungry?
Decolonial
thought is the foundation for decentering Western imaginaries of man, Western imaginaries of its Edenic nature in peril, separate from us. And so that's at the core of this reimagining. Thank you for your question.
Okay, I hear there's some food which is a bit in delay, so actually we have room for one or two questions more. So,
are we hungry?
Yes.
Thank you for such a thought-provoking talk. So I'm an avid gardener, so I really need to let go of my Edenic visions. I'm wondering if it's really doable. I mean, I understand the call for doing as little harm as possible. But is it really possible to completely be non-biopolitical? So I'm thinking, so if a human being has some sort of illness, we're going to do our best to save that life, right? Even if it means killing a virus. So we're establishing some sort of hierarchy of which life is more useful or valuable.
Yeah, and that's the definition that we've always had about gardening. And so one of the things that I love about those fine workers, he unmakes and remakes our idea of an enclosure, right? Where are the boundaries of our garden? What do we weed on the inside of our garden? What do we let live, etc.? And so this desire in his gardening practices really invites us. He collects plants from the roadside, feral plants from the roadside, and brings them to his garden and makes the most minimal interventions and then watches who grows. Like, what is this being up to? What is this being up to? Who likes to grow here? Who likes to grow there? I met a graduate student recently who's studying tobacco growers in India, where they're trying to grow tobacco under 50 degree days with no rain. For an economy that is built around this incredibly addictive and powerful substance. And I had to remind her, you know, tobacco is one of the most sacred plants on this planet. It knows how to do things, and recently it's been calling in a parasite. So I helped her to reinterpret what was going on. The tobacco, they've been fighting off this parasite that comes in and grows with the tobacco, and they say kills the tobacco, but competes for the tobacco. And I was like, what if we looked at that relation differently? What if we saw the tobacco as calling in this other being to help it break its relation to capitalism, right? How does the tobacco refuse to participate in capitalist extraction and say, I don't want to grow here, and it calls in this parasite? So part of it is to say, who wants to grow here and there? And we have to question our desires for making a plant grow in this one place just because of a particular kind of attachment. What does letting die allow us to mean? This question, again, of forced life is something we have to contend with. When are we making things live in places and in worlds that are breaking everything else around it? And so this lovely story of your rose in the garden, this question of what could you plant next to that rose, right? In permaculture, the kinds of plant companionships that maybe your plant is lonely for some other kind of relation. Maybe there are other things, and sort of the slowness of being with it and asking it what it really wants. And maybe it doesn't want to be there. Maybe it wants to be moved elsewhere. Maybe it would prefer more sun, less shade, etc. So these are different kinds of attunements that can both allow you to be of service to this plant, but forgetting everything we thought we know of how to do that work. So bringing in the pesticides to do that may not be the kindest way to support your plant.
Okay, are there other questions? There's one here.
Okay. It doesn't want to be there, maybe it wants to be moved elsewhere. Maybe it would prefer more sun, less shade, etc. So these are different kinds of attunements that can both allow you to be of service to this plant, but forgetting everything we thought we know of how to do that work. So bringing in the pesticides to do that may not be the kindest way to support your plant. Thank
you. Okay, are there other questions? There's one here.
Okay. Thank you so much for the extremely inspirational and very stimulating talk in terms of further ideas and projects. My question, I suppose, in several parts is just regarding that material semiosis of your poetics. Several of your rhetorical structures I'm particularly curious about, and how the usage practices, which are so clear, I think, where those words and languages come from, but then in terms of how they inform your concept. The first being, just in speaking of plants as pulling us or calling to us. And I found your comment about rethinking frames and definitions of consciousness from pain to pleasure particularly powerful. But along those lines, does attributing agency to plants consciousness to plants?
So this is also where we have to do a lot of work. Just hearing the anxiety and this notion that we would have to attribute sentience to others, and that would be some sort of human imposition onto these other beings, that is for me precisely the marker of the extent to which our ways of thinking are deeply Western, right? So that underneath everything is a fundamental skepticism of the possibility that any other being could possibly have forms of consciousness, and I would hope they're not like ours, right? You know, I would hope they're not like ours. But we have to pay attention to the ways that I've written extensively on how mechanism in the life sciences aims to disenchant the living world, and even as scientists fail so often to apply mechanism in a way that would disenchant the world. But our mechanical metaphors, and it's amazing what we do, we talk about human sentience and human consciousness in these most remarkable terms, but we've relegated the rest of the world to mechanical bits who can't have any kind of intention of their own. Mechanism, I've learned, is one of the most violent forms of anthropomorphism, because what it does is it renders everybody else a machine available for our use. Right? There's a move inside of that, so we act when we refuse to allow for the beings around us to be sentient. We do that because we think at the core that no mechanical bits and parts could possibly come together in some, you know, synergistic whole to produce sentience. We've reduced that being, but mechanism isn't, we would not normally think that's attributing human ideas, but it's attributing human use to plants, or human use to other beings. And so breaking with that mode of anthropomorphism and practicing an anthropomorphism that allows us to be with beings that are other than ours and learn from them and be moved by them, and that all the work has to happen on us. And it's the colonial common sense that would have us apprehend the world as bits and parts of machines, which are precisely as resources and commodities. And all of that work we've done in the sciences has produced that fissure, has produced that separation, and we're living in the wake of that, repairing that relation. And it's not about us attributing consciousness to them. They gave us sentience. And so part of it is imagining otherwise. They gave us the possibility of forms of relation and forms of encounter and nourishment and shelter and all of this other, and they've shaped our economies and our cultures so profoundly. The piece that we're missing is we've lost the depth of all of our culture's plant knowledge. Okay, there are so many cultural forms of plant knowledge around in the world, including Western forms that we are deeply disconnected from. So unless you're a farmer or a gardener, you have no idea what the names of the plants outside are. And so part of that transforming again our learning and making all of our schooling about learning about these plants could be one way. And you wouldn't even have this question. It wouldn't be a question, are they alive or not, or sentient or not. It's not even a question anymore. So I'm curious about, you know, in part, I'm reading a lot of indigenous scholars right now who are like, oh, the sciences are catching up to all the things we've already known. But in a sense, we don't need the sciences to tell us about the swarm intelligence in plant roots or the computational programs that plants are running in their bodies that like lock into our ideas about intelligence. And so I think there's a lot of room here for displacing assumptions that go back to questions about who we eat, that go back to questions about who we acknowledge, and the question of like just going through the motions of acknowledging those beings around us, even if you don't believe it yet. Soon you may come to believe that in fact, oh, wait, that's speaking to me in some way. It's telling me something, and it has a wisdom that you have no idea yet, and a form of knowing you may not begin to apprehend.
Yeah. Thank you very much. Okay. I think time is running now, so we will end on that note. And thank you so much for a highly engaging lecture.